Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la وتركنا على المحجة البيضاء ليلها كنهارها لا يزيغ عنها إلا هالك. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وما قل وكفى خير مما كفر وألهى وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. All praises due to Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship but Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad Rasulullah is the true slave servant, prophet, and last messenger of Allah. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him, his household, his companions, and everybody following him till the day of judgment. Allahumma ameen. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal with his names and attributes at this beautiful day of Al-Jum'ah, at this house of his, to make us among those who listen and to follow the best of what they listen to. My dear brothers and sisters, we are in the month of Al-Muharram, the beginning of the Hijri year. Have you thought before about the word Hijri year? What is Hijri year? What is the result? What is it the result of? It is the result of Mashura of the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many years after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they wanted to have a calendar according to which they manage their affairs, manage their lives. And they wanted to start that calendar with a major incident. That's how Al-Arab used to calculate things, by major incidents. So they said the year of the elephant, that's a major incident. That year, such and such happened. I was born a year before it, 5 years after. That marriage happened 10 years later, 3 years before. That's how they used to, right? That's how they used to. So now, the state of Al-Islam, it is beyond Medina. There are different cultures, different needs, there are different people, there is an army, there is economy, there are social life. So they wanted to have a calendar according to which they manage their affairs, all right? So then they said, where we start? Which incident we go by and it becomes year number one? It becomes year number one. So the suggestion was the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It changed the face of history. It changed it for everybody till yawm al-qiyamah, the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to this earth. Then it becomes year number one, and then they calculate and they see they are in year 70 or year. It will become year 70, but year number one will become the Mawlid. Or it is the reception of the revelation, like the first revelation. It is a major incident, guidance for mankind, guidance for humanity. The Quran, the Sharia, the constitution of Allah Azza wa Jalla, according to which this Muslim Ummah will increase and will implement and will act and will be responsible in front of Allah. So that's a major thing. So we start and it becomes year number one. And the third suggestion was the Hijrah. The Hijrah should be the major incident according to which we start our calendar, or we start our calendar from. And subhanAllah, this was the Mashura of the Sahaba, and they chose the Hijrah. Because the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the reception of the revelation, you know, were crowned by the Hijrah. Hijrah is what made the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the reception of the revelation find the community, find the jama'ah. So the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam means something to the Muslimin, the jama'ah. And the reception of the Quran is to be implemented. Quran is to be implemented, and Hijrah paved the way for that. While they were in Mecca, they were challenged, they were persecuted, there were always hurdles, there were always problems. To start. There were issues in Medina, but after started already. Those are the challenges that come with the system. But in Mecca, there was challenges for the system not to start. And that's why the Hijrah came to give that way. And from that, we learn a lesson. And that's our khutbah today. We're learning the lesson from that model. So the Sahaba chose the Hijrah as the major incident and became year number one. It became year number one. And that's how we go according to it. Before they knew that a year starts with Muharram and ends with the Hijjah. They know Ramadan is month number 9. They knew all of those. But they did not have a calendar system. So the new thing is the calendar system. Right? So that's the Hijri year. Alhamdulillah, we started the Hijri year now, 1438, since that Hijrah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We learn a lesson. Sometimes we get, my brothers and sisters, so focused and fixated on one of the details and make it like the goal. Well, the goal is much bigger than that. And this is a detail only, detail only. But you see the system of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this model of al-Din of al-Islam. When Allah revealed to him, فَاصْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرْ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Now you have to deliver the message. Before, when he said, I'm a prophet, there was no issue in Mecca. When he said that people follow me and I believe in one God, and he said that from the beginning, one God only, no mushrikeen, there was no issues in Mecca. But when he told people that this is the right thing and everything else is wrong, then it's an issue. And when he told them you have to abandon everything you do and follow me, that became a bigger issue. فَاصْدَعْ بِمَا تُؤْمَرُ. Then the Islam became challenged, because now it is going to change not only the lives of the individual, but it is going to change the community. It is going to change the system. Remember that word. It is going to change what? The system. And whenever people are satisfied and comfortable with the system, changing it is a big deal. Changing it is a big deal. Whatever that system, you can change individual. You can have followers and enemies and friends. You can claim whatever you want and you can do whatever you like. But when you want to change the system, there is an issue. That's why Waraq ibn Nawfal told the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hijra, it was implied and referred to from the time Rasulullah received Iqra, Bismi Rabbik. It was something expected. Even him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, himself did not know. We know the story of Waraq ibn Nawfal, right? All of us. He goes and tells him, oh, this is revelation, you are a prophet like Musa alayhi salam, all of that good. We all know this part. But what did he tell him next? He tell him, I wish I am young and strong to follow you, especially when your people of Mecca, exile you from it, get you out of here. So that's the reference to Hijrah. As early as Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. So it's the first word that changes the system, you expect that this is going to happen. So we learn that how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invested in the leaders, in preparing leaders. Step number one to change the system is to prepare the leaders. That's why sometimes we get busy with the detail. Why they were suffering, why they were not fighting back, why they were not doing this, they were not doing that. You're missing the whole point. They were in a training. Being challenged was meant to be. They have to be challenged to the extreme, that they have to give up their life to know that everything here is to be given up for Allah's cause. So that was intended for them. That's why they come to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say, Rasulullah, why are you not making dua? Themselves, the Sahaba of Rasulullah, make dua to Allah to relieve us from this. Don't you think Allah was able to finish everything and Mecca become the state of Islam and kullu everything, mashallah, next? Wa Abu Jahl become Muslim, everything, halas. But no challenge. They got it the easy way. Then what's going to happen to all the challenges for Islam and Muslimin till Yawm al-Qiyamah? There has to be some people who set an example. So you cannot fight back at that time, and you have to take everything and be strong. So step number one, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invested in teaching them the strong aqeedah. Teaching them about al-yawm al-akhirah. Teach them about the ayat of Allah, the heavens, the stars, the sea, the rivers, everything around them, that there is a day of judgment. You have to be moral. You have to have a code. You have to have values. Whatever happens to you, you don't change your values. No compromising. لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَ دِينُ. Like that, right? So that's what it is. Then step number two, now when the leaders are ready, they need a place. And that place here, it is not a fertile land. Not yet. Later will come. But not now. So the Hijra comes. Rasulullah tell them to go to Al-Habasha. That's a host place. Then later on comes Al-Madina. Al-Madina. And don't think that Rasulullah and his Sahaba just came to Medina like from an airplane and they just landed on Medina like that. No. There were also a special type of people who prepared the way and paved the way for Rasulullah and the Sahaba to be in Medina. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while in Mecca, listen to this carefully, my brothers. What a da'i or a leader or someone who believes in the cause will do. To which extent, to what extent he or she should go. Rasulullah himself, the most important person on earth at the time and all the time, the best of mankind, the best, the merciful mankind, himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He goes and go tribe by tribe while they are in the season of Hajj. Would you help me? Would you accept that I come to your tribe? Because my people, my family, my own tribe, they are against me. Would you accept me? What do we get? In the dunya? Nothing. You get leadership? No. You get money? Absolutely not. Actually, you're going to give. Everybody's going to become your friend? No. Actually, everybody's going to become your enemy. Look to what he's selling. Look to what he's selling, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He goes to a tribe that has its name, that has its system, that has their allies, and he tells them, accept me and you will lose everything. Accept me and you will lose everything. But I am promising you something that you don't see, that you don't hear, but it's much bigger. Now someone, our youth, people, business people, might think, what kind of deal is this? What kind of salesperson is that? Subhanallah. But that's the whole point, by the way. He doesn't want any buyer. He does not want any buyer. He's looking for a specific one. You know, when somebody in the market, they are targeting certain people. They are telling you in the business, who is your target audience? Who is your target customers? So sometimes you open, you find the car dealership. So who buys these cars? Nobody is in there. You go certain dealership and you find people lining up and they're making sales and they're making advertisement. But there are other dealers, they don't even advertise. Yes? They don't advertise. So anybody else passing by, what do you, he or she will say? What kind of business is this? No customers. Actually, that's the whole point of that business. They don't want you as a customer. They want certain people. They don't want the crowd. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam wanting certain people. And that's why he goes to one tribe after the other and said, yo, after you finish, we agree. After you are done, we become the leaders. He said, no. إِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لِلَّهِ يُورِثُهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. He said, okay, you have half and we have half. No. So you take the religious leadership, we take the worldly thing. No. You accept as I'm telling you, I am a prophet of Allah. That's the whole line. That is where you should put 100 lines under. When you believe that he is the prophet of Allah, any discussion after that goes one way only. That's the lesson here I'm emphasizing, right? When you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, the whole discussion has to go one way only. When you say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan, Rasulullah, then the whole discussion goes one way only. No negotiations here. I hope this one is clear. That is what he was looking for, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But those who negotiated, they did not pay attention to that, I am the Prophet of Allah part. You know, I received the revelation from Rabbul Alameen. Means you have to be believing in Rabbul Alameen. And I am his messenger. And anything comes after that will lead you to sacrifice everything basically. You accept or you don't accept. But if you discuss details, means you did not get it. You did not get it. That's why when an Ansar came and told him, what is for us? He said, Jannatun arduha as-samawati wal-ard. A Jannah, the width of which is heavens and earth, said, we accept. That's okay. Because they looked also to the material benefit. If all of us, as the mujtama' or the community of Medina, which is fighting, which have enmity, which have problems, which is challenged, all of that, if we believe in that, means every problem and dispute will disappear automatically. So they actually found the benefit, but first they have to believe in the unseen. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ first, الْغَيْبِ. First one. يُؤْمِنُونَ الْغَيْبِ. So that's lesson number two. When you submit to Allah, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا, What you are afraid to lose, actually you will gain. Actually you will gain. So first, don't make the material benefit distract you from believing in Allah. Don't take the material benefit as standard to accept or not the way of Allah. Once you accept the way of Allah, take it for granted that there will be material benefit as well. But this one comes first, and this comes second. Those are two main things. And that's what the Sahaba were prepared before. Al-Ansar was working on that front. He sent some muhajirin to teach them, those 70 plus, 1 year. Second year, so 2 years they have been working on it. Plus, and people accepting Islam, Mus'ab ibn Umair teaching Quran, there are halaqas, there is Salat Jum'ah also, there is Salat al-Jama'ah also. Don't worry about how, that's not the issue. The issue is the principles were established. And this is a Jama'ah, a community uniting and growing, even before Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam goes. And that is one person who was prepared in Mecca. Mus'ab ibn Umair, young man, in his 20s. And he learned, like for a decade with Rasulullah, he graduated from that university of Mecca. And then he goes to Medina, and because of him, a whole society was ready to change history forever. So system is important, right? And preparing a leader is more important. When the system is there, so a leader has to be prepared. A leader has to be prepared, subhanAllah. A person was talking to me this morning about social media. Facebook, everybody, whether you are on Facebook or not. But somebody was telling me, said, you know, Shiekh, and he studied this very well. So this is his field of, or the area of study. Social media and promotions and all of that. So I said, do you know, there are some speakers and famous people that they have million likes for their page, right? And some other people, they have 200 or 300. Which one you think is better? Which one you think is more effective? So everybody would say, the one who's celebrity, the one who's big. He said, you know, statistics say that the more people who follow you, the less they will listen to you, the shorter time. So you have million likes, why? Because you are fast food. But if you are going to give a lecture for an hour, you are not going to find million people listening to it, right? But the one who have 200, when he gives the lecture, 50 will sit for a lecture for 1 hour for 12 weeks. So 50 out of 200. But the million, he speaks more than 15 minutes, everybody lost interest. Because everybody's famous for 15 minutes, right? Yeah. So it's not what you think sometimes. It is what you do. You can teach or talk 2 million people and make them feel happy. But you can educate 10 people who can change history later. Your choice. It's your choice. Everyone have that. And that's why Rasulullah was investing these 13 years in Mecca for this type of people. Each one of them goes to one place and changes the whole community and jama'ah. He believes in value and he knows the system. So first, prepare the muhajirin. One of the muhajirin goes and prepare, who will become later al-Ansar. So now the jama'ah is ready. Then the leader arrives. Get the best leader there is, the most qualified speaker there is. If people are not prepared to listen, is no effect. Get the best doctor there is. If no patients in that hospital for his specialty, he's good at everything. He has certificates filling the wall, but then, and he's good in his skill, but nobody to operate on in that specialty. No one have that issue here. So what is going to be doing? Get the best of hospital on the other side with the top-notch, latest, cutting-edge technology. But you don't have qualified physicians in it, so what is the value? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was working on both. He's preparing those doctors and leaders and teachers, and he's working with that hospital and school and the university and the building and the jama'ah. So step number one, step number two. Then when he goes sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Medina, he builds the masjid. But masjid is what was needed before he built his own house sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his house sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an attachment to the masjid. I want you to remember that word, was annexed to the masjid. I'm not talking about proximity here, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about my house is secondary to the masjid, not the other way around. Not the other way around. Living away from the masjid or not, no problem. Even Rasulullah advised the Ansar who wanted to move closer to the masjid, he said, no, stay wherever you are, you have more ajr coming. So the point is not proximity here. I'm not focusing on proximity. That the house of Rasulullah is attached to the masjid, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about before he think building his house, he stayed a few weeks actually in Medina as a guest. Do you think, yani, before he goes to Medina, he was not able to give the signal, build me a house? Build me a house. But that's not what was his concern. It was not even the concern of the Sahaba. It is more than that. It is more than that. The arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is more important than all of that. There are people prepared, there is a system, and there is a community ready to move on. Not a community who are numbered, but they are figuring it out. No, they know, they're already ready for it. And when the masjid is built, it started functioning from the first day. Started functioning from the first day. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam built the masjid as a foundation of the ummah, of the Muslim jama'ah in Medina. That is what was missing. They were praying, they were socializing, they were visiting each other, they were having jama'ah salah. So when the masjid was built, it's like the symbol that everything is manifested in. So instead of being scattered, the masjid unites. We have issues, the masjid will solve. We need guidance, we're in the masjid. Yes, so that's how it is. Masjid fits in place. So whatever is needed will start coming up. But the people were built before that. The system were established from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he prepared the leaders who just needed a place. The graduates were there before even the university has a building. They were graduates who will build one university after the other. Don't be just fixated on building a building, or making the building, the physical walls and the ceiling and this and that, and become satisfied that, oh, this is my project. That's not the point. You're missing it. That's not the point. You need to convince people first that what you are thinking about is what they need. So they will make that happen, even after you die, no big deal. Doesn't matter. But your idea is planted in people's mind, that's where you build the masjid. That's where you build the masjid first. That's where, here and here. So all the life goes around it. It is not to fit in my schedule. It's not only full in Jumu'ah, but in Fajr as well. In Isha as well, when the seerah of the Prophet is taught as well, when kids have a class as well, when sisters have a class as well. And instead of complaining, sister, no class, youth don't have program. Well, we need to educate youth that masjid is important first, that they need to love the Quran first. SubhanAllah, I want to share with you something amazing. In the second khutbah, inshallah, أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله العظيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. For the sake of time, my brothers and sisters, when I was here in Ramadan and I was talking after Fajr about the parables of the Quran, and in Isha about the stories of the Quran, someone, الحمد لله رب العالمين, initiated an effort to teach the youth how to read the Quran. This might sound not related for you or for us. Might sound not related. That why that brother initiated this, and why those youth, they were making the effort here, they wanted to learn Alif Ba, how to recite the Quran and all of that. This, according to education terminology in this country and everywhere, called the unintended curriculum, the hidden curriculum. There is direct curriculum, is the subject that you teach and the lesson. And there is an indirect one, another lesson, but that's not the main one. But the hidden one is what happens based on this. You did not write it. Just quickly, you have a lesson in the book about sharing for children. And it has pictures in it, and you know, children sharing sandwiches, food, and all that. And they are standing in a playground, a boy and a girl, and a few here, a few there, like this. So that is the lesson. That's called direct curriculum. That's what I'm teaching kids to share. Right? Now, what is the indirect curriculum? Sharing is good, it makes you a better person. Right? That's the indirect. It's a good thing, it makes you feel good. But it's not written there. But what is the indirect curriculum? That is how someone good looks like. The picture. That's how someone good looks like. And that can be very dangerous, by the way. So here in curriculum, we have the masjid, we have activities, we have everything good. But the teacher has a style that drives people away. So what is the hidden curriculum here? That I have a masjid which telling me everything is halal, everything is good, I love Allah and I love His Rasul, but it is very hard on me to do. While the other side, I know it is wrong, but everything is given to me in a very nice way. So that's the hidden curriculum. I hope you understand. And the Rasulullah was working on very clear from the beginning. The hidden curriculum is you believe in Allah. No hidden. Everything there is clear for you. And that's why the Sahaba were focused. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us among those who learn from the hijrah of Rasulullah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla bless this jama'ah, bless this community, bless this masjid. And may Allah Azza wa Jalla bless all the members of this jama'ah and those who are managing the affairs of it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who are united, who have pure intentions. May Allah Azza wa Jalla fix our deeds. May Allah Azza wa Jalla forgive our sins. May Allah guide us. May Allah unite our efforts. May Allah give victory to the Muslim Ummah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give victory to the mustada'afin, those who are weak, those who are transgressed. May Allah release those who are imprisoned and those who are oppressed. And may Allah Azza wa Jal pay the debts of those who are in debt. And may Allah Azza wa Jal cure and give healing and shifa to those who are sick. And may Allah cover with His mercy those who passed away among our families and among our communities. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَكَفِّرْ عَنَّا سَيِّئَاتِنَا وَتَوَفَّنَا مَعَ الْأَبْرَارِ عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. أقيم الصلاة.